Good morning, buddy. Hopefully you had a good and warm weekend and your team won the Super Bowl, hopefully. So we'll go ahead and jump in here. Last week's 5Q tape breakdown. Here's how you should start a 21-point checklist meeting with a few pointers that could have been perfect. So why do you want to start the meeting right? Because you start anything right, it's going to lay down the groundwork for how that meeting's going to go. So the reason we start it the way we do is it lowers their resistance level. It makes them more calm. Makes them feel like they're in control. So make sure you take a look at that so we can start those 21s in the right way. Why would we want to do that? Well, here's a great chart I ran across showing the power of tiny gains. So if we got 1% better every day, so 1.01 is 1% better. To the 365th power, that means you'd be 37 times better by the end of the year. And how do we get 1% better a day? Give me some examples how we could get 1% better a day. Maybe not even, let's talk about 5Q, let's talk about business, but how other ways? What are some other ways you can get 1% better every day? Training, reading, knowledge, yep. Chart, absolutely. Read, yep, Nick. 15-minute drill is a perfect way to get better at our system. Yep, absolutely, Tom. How else? Smile, I go along with that. Getting better at GOTS, yep. That's so it's 15-minute drill. Listen to tapes. Yeah, there's so many different ways we can get better every single day. Should we ever go to bed and not have gotten better that day? If that happens, what's happening to that person? Yeah, June, you got to implement what you learn as well. Exactly right. Learning something is worthless unless you're implementing it. Yeah, you go backwards. Exactly right. So let's take a look at it. This is a riddle. Look closely at this picture and identify the total in the last column. So what is this answer here? I'll give you a chance. Let me see some answers in this. Everybody do this exercise. What's the answer to this equation? So we got 22, 19, 19. 60. Let me see a couple more. Actually, go through this exercise, guys. Nineteen, 14. John's got the right answer. Okay, so let's walk through this. So we got three pair of boots, which means each of these pair of boots would be worth what? 10, exactly right, chart. Then we have a pair of boots, which we know is 10. And then we have two boys here, which means each of those boys have to add up to what? 10. So each of those boys are what? 5, exactly. Then we know this is 5. This is 13. So what's the difference between 5 and 13? What's the difference? 8. So each of these pairs of ribbons are what? Yeah, 4 each. Okay, so then what do we got here? So we've got how many boots? How many boots? One. So that would be worth what then? Remember, the boots are worth 10, but we only have one boot. So that would be worth what? Five, that's right. Then we have a ribbon. The ribbons are worth 4, so one ribbon is worth what? Two, that's right. And we have a boy here, right? And the boy is worth what? What did we say the boy is worth? Five. But is this boy different from the other boys? How is he different? Okay. So what is this boy worth? He's not worth five. He's worth what? He's worth five, and a pair of ribbons is worth four. That's 13. And a pair of boots is worth what? 10. So this boy is worth how much? Five, nine, and a pair of boots is worth 10. He's worth how much? Yeah. So then what's his answer then? Yeah, I got a headache too, Gerard. Yeah, so some of you missed the multiplication here as well, right? So these are plus, 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 plus. This is a multiplication. But here's the funny thing. John got the correct answer right up front. And you should have been able to get it in 10 seconds. Because it says, look closely at this picture and identify the total in the last what? Column. So the last column is what? Last column is what? 30, 20, and 13 is 63. But instead, we jump through all of these hoops. Why did we do that? Yeah, John's got it. That's exactly. We made a lot of assumptions. Why did we go through jump through all these hoops and all these details? We didn't follow the instructions closely. Now, as salespeople, guess what? Because I did when I did this riddle, I did it the exact same way. So I came up with the wrong answer three times before I finally got the answer right. So why is that the case? Because as salespeople, we want to get to what as soon as possible. Do we want to understand the problem, or do we want to get to the solution as quickly as possible? Now, the bottom line, that's right. We want to get to the bottom line as quickly as possible. But if we don't pay attention to the details, what can happen? How big a problem can happen if we don't pay attention to the details? Now, this is just a riddle. But how about in life? If we don't pay attention to the details, how big a problem can we get into? A little problem or a big problem? And if you think about it, guys, our clients, what would be an indication of our clients in this demonstration here? What would be an indication of our clients? They want to get to the bottom line. What is the only thing your clients are worried about? 90% of them. What's the only thing they're worried about? Yeah, make the most money, Ron. Not losing money, John. The money, money, money. That's right, Dale. Money, 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 money. And in the end, if they aren't paying attention, if all they're worried about is what's their rate of return at the end of the year, what are they missing? How many things are they missing that could really cause them huge harm? A few things or a lot of things? Few things or a lot of things? Yeah, 21 things, right? So our job is to do what with our clients? Have them refocus on the details. Because if they're not focusing on the details, they're going to miss plenty of things that's going to get them into a bad situation. Okay? So this is a fun little exercise to demonstrate we got to pay attention to the details. If it was the last row, how many wrong answers did we get before we got the right answer? Even if instead of it saying column, it said row, we got a lot of wrong answers because we were missing little details, that there was one boot instead of two, that there was a multiplication sign instead of all addition, that this boy had two ribbons and boots on. So even if it was rows, we got them wrong. Most people got it, including myself, got these things wrong an awful lot. But then you add this, and then we get lots of wrong problems or wrong answers. So we have to pay attention to details, not just us, but our clients as well. Now, what would be an indication of us not paying attention to details? What are we concerned with? And I'll I'll see if Jeff, what answer Jeff comes up with. Jeff, when we're talking to a new person on the system, what's the number one thing they're worried about?
Seeing new people.
Yeah, marketing, 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 right? How am I going to market? How am I going to market? How am I going to market? Guys, if somebody comes on the system and all they're going to do is market, what kind of success are they going to have? The same success they've always had. And how many people? We have a bus pulled up. We have a bus. First of all, how lucky are we that we come across somebody who Jeff calls a four-leaf clover, that one in 10,000 that wants to do business with us? That's right, Mark. So when a bus pulls up, and we have to assume that at best, we're going to get 10% of people, or one out of 10 people. We're at the right place at the right time for that person, and that they just moved to town and they're looking for a new advisor, or their advisor died, or their advisor retired, or their advisor made a mistake, or the client just retired and is looking for an advisor. Because if all we do is the other nine people, the other nine out of 10 people, the other 90% of people, they're happy with where they're at right now. And if we show somebody who's happy where they're at right now with a good idea, what percentage of those people are going to move? That's right. They're not going to move. They're not going to, if they've got money and they're happy with where they are right now, they're not going to move for a good idea. Why? Because moving for a good idea could do what to their current situation? Screw it up, right? So should we be more worried about marketing, or should we be more worried about being able to close a tire kicker and a plate licker when we start marketing? What should be more important, closing a tire kicker and a plate licker or marketing? Because if you can close tire kickers and plate lickers at a high percentage, at 80 or 90%, how much marketing, even if marketing sucks, how much marketing are you going to do? A lot. Does that make sense? So did you all take advantage of November and December and hone those 21-point checklist skills? Being paying attention to the right things. So we talked about getting 1% better a day. Let's look at another way we could do that. New York Times, self-care, what's this all about journaling? One of the most effective acts of self-care is also happily one of the cheapest. Once the domain of teenage girls and literati, journaling has become a hallmark of the so-called self-care movement, right up there with meditation, and for good reason. Scientific studies have shown it to be essential and a panacea of modern life. Guys, those of you out there, how many scientific studies have said journaling is a good thing? A few or a lot? That's right, Ron. A lot of them. A lot of them. A lot of them. Scientific studies have shown that it's essential to a panacea of modern life. There are obvious benefits like a boost in mindfulness, memory, and communication skills. But studies have also found that writing a journal can lead to better sleep, a stronger immune system, and more self-confidence and a higher IQ. How many of us could use better sleep? How many of us in today's world could use a stronger immune system? How about more self-confidence? How about a higher IQ? Research out of New Zealand suggests that the practice may even help wounds heal faster. How is this possible? A social psychologist at the University of Texas at Austin, who's considered the pioneer of writing therapy, said there isn't one answer. It's a whole cascade of things that occur, he said. Now, guys, I understand this sounds like a bunch of new age gobbledygook motivational BS. I get it. I get it. I'm not a big fan of new age gobbly BS, but why do I meditate? If I'm not a big fan of new age gobbledygook, why do I meditate every day? Because it's new age, or why? It works. Why does it work, Nick? How do I know it works? Because science and research has what? Proven that it works. And there's huge amounts of research out there about journaling too. Now, Inc. Is Inc. a New Age magazine, or is it a business magazine? New Age or business? Business, right? But even there, productivity. Writing three sentences each day can massively boost your productivity and happiness. So you don't even need to be a huge journal writer and spend hours and hours and hours doing it or figuring out how to do it. Just writing three sentences each day can massively boost your productivity. So I already said, sleep, immune system, happiness, IQ, and now we've got what? Productivity, right? A challenge to find a daily habit that delivers more self-improvement for your bang for your buck. As someone who writes about productivity and success, I come across a lot of life hacks, many of them sensible and research-backed. Meditate, spend time in nature, experience awe, have a hobby, keep a journal. The list goes on and on and on. In fact, it goes on so long that anyone who follows this general advice quickly senses a problem. If I tried to do all these things, not only would your schedule explode, but you'd also would your brain would explode. In a recent post by the Happiness Equation, author Neil Pasricha, whatever, Pasricha, I don't know, delivers just such a nugget of self-improvement gold. The post tells a story of how he clawed his way out of depressed workaholism, but that actionable takeaway from this tale is a simple addition to your daily routine. Science attests that it improves both your mental health and your productivity in mere minutes a day. It boils down to just completing just three sentences. So guys, should you do your journaling on your computer or in on pen and paper? Pen and paper. The three sentences. I will focus on blank. Number two, I am grateful for blank. How much research is there about being grateful, showing gratitude, or thinking about what you're grateful for every day? Lots? Yeah, tons. I will let go of blank. Why is this important? I will let go of blank. Why is that important? Because worrying about what happened yesterday is that baggage, right, Ron? Worrying about what happened yesterday, distraction, right? So, how long would it take for you to do this? You know, I'm a writer and I've been a writer for 60 years now, 60 years, probably 50 of those 60 years, and I've never done a journal. Guess what this article now has me doing? Because journaling, I thought, I don't want to put down my feelings and go through my brain and do all that crap. I don't got time for that. I ain't got time for that. But how easy is it to do these three sentences? Super easy. So I am now journaling because it's a new age thing or because it's science backed. That's great to hear, Ron. Ron says he and his wife do it every single day. That's great to hear. And does it help you, Ron? I mean, have you found, how long have you been doing it, Ron? And does it, and why, and you're a very good businessman. So why would you do that? 5 years, he said. So has it been helpful? Would you stop? What do you think would happen if you stopped doing it? He says, I can't stop. So guys, these are just, do you think this would help your business? Do you think this would help your family and relationships? So this is a good idea, but if you don't do it, what's going to happen? So what should you do as soon as you get off the call today? Either run down to Target or get online and order a journal and start doing this every single day. Does that make sense? So here's another way we can get a little bit better every day. Something we do every single day, but guess how much all of us need improvement? We can improve the way we talk. So I actually have the 10 things we're going to talk about today. It's one of TED Talk's top talks. It's 11 minutes long, and it's one of the most viewed talks on TED Talks over the last decade. And it's about talking about how we can talk better. And I actually have these 10 things printed and on my wall, and I look at them once a week. Regular, I look at them every single week. Not because I don't know why. Okay, why do I look at these? Why do you think I look at something that I've known for almost half a century? Why do I look at it every single week, even though I've known it for a half a century? Half a century, guys. A half a 50 years. You have to reinforce if I don't, because when I look at these 10 things, guess how many times I can, and we'll get into the 10 things here in a second, but guess how many times I break these rules every single day? None or way too many? Way too many. Because even though we know the rules, we're more concerned about, because getting better at the way we talk, you think that's about the way I'm talking? What do you think it's about? Before we jump into it, do you think getting better at the way we talk or having conversations is about me? Yes, it's Nick. It's about listening. So this is a great 11-minute talk. Like I said, it's one of the top TED Talks for the last decade in viewership. So let's take a listen to what this gal has to say here. Just a second here when I get it up. There's no sound yet, so we'll get here in a second. There we go. Can everybody hear it okay? Can it get some yays?
All right, I want to see a show of hands. How many of you have unfriended someone on Facebook because they said something offensive about politics or religion, childcare, food? And how many of you know at least one person that you avoid because you just don't want to talk to them? You know, it used to be that in order to have a polite conversation, we just had to follow the advice of Henry Higgins and My Fair Lady, stick to the weather and your health. But these days, with climate change and anti-vaxxing, those subjects are not safe either. So this world that we live in, this world in which every conversation has the potential to devolve into an argument where our politicians can't speak to one another, and where even the most trivial of issues have someone fighting both passionately for it and against it, it's not normal. Pew Research did a study of 10,000 American adults, and they found that at this moment, we are more polarized, we are more divided than we ever have been in history. We're less likely to compromise, which means we're not listening to each other, and we make decisions about where to live, who to marry, and even who our friends are going to be based on what we already believe. Again, that means we're not listening to each other. A conversation requires a balance between talking and listening, and somewhere along the way, we lost that balance. Now, part of that is due to technology, the smartphones that you all either have in your hands or close enough that you could grab them really quickly. According to Pew Research, about a third of American teenagers send more than 100 texts a day. And many of them, almost most of them, are more likely to text their friends than they are to talk to them face to face. There's this great piece in The Atlantic. It was written by a high school teacher named Paul Barnwell. And he gave his kids a communication project. He wanted to teach them how to speak on a specific subject without using notes. And he said this, I came to realize that conversational competence might be the single most overlooked skill we fail to teach. Kids spend hours each day engaging with ideas and each other through screens, but rarely do they have an opportunity to hone their interpersonal communication skills. It might sound like a funny question, but we have to ask ourselves, is there any 21st century skill more important than being able to sustain coherent, confident conversation? Now, I make my living talking to people. Nobel Prize winners, truck drivers, billionaires, kindergarten teachers, heads of state, plumbers. I talk to people that I like. I talk to people that I don't like. I talk to some people that I disagree with deeply on a personal level, but I still have a great conversation with them. So I'd like to spend the next 10 minutes or so teaching you how to talk and how to listen. Many of you have already heard a lot of advice on this. Things like look the person in the eye, think of interesting things, topics to discuss in advance, nod and smile to show that you're paying attention, repeat back what you just heard or summarize it. So I want you to forget all of that. It is crap. There is no reason to learn how to show you're paying attention if you are in fact paying attention. Now, I actually use the exact same skills as a professional interviewer that I do in regular life. So I'm going to teach you how to interview people, and that's actually going to help you learn how to be better conversationalists, learn to have a conversation without wasting your time, without getting bored, and please God, without offending anybody. We've all had really great conversations. We've had them before. We know what it's like. The kind of conversation where you walk away feeling engaged and inspired, or where you feel like you've made a real connection or you've been perfectly understood. There is no reason why most of your interactions can't be like that. So I have 10 basic rules. I'm going to walk you through all of them. But honestly, if you just choose one of them and master it, you're already going to enjoy better conversations. Number one, don't multitask. And I don't mean just set down your cell phone or your tablet or your car keys or whatever's in your hand. I mean, be present. Be in that moment. Don't be thinking about your argument you have with your boss, don't be thinking about what you're going to have for dinner. If you want to get out of the conversation, get out of the conversation, but don't be half in it and half out of it. Number two, don't pontificate. If you want to just state your opinion without any opportunity for response or argument or pushback or growth, write a blog. Now, there's a really good reason why I don't allow pundits on my show, because they're really boring. If they're a conservative, they're going to hate Obama and food stamps and abortion. If they're a liberal, they're going to hate big banks and oil corporations and Dick Cheney. Totally predictable. And you don't want to be like that. You need to enter every conversation assuming that you have something to learn. The famed therapist M. Scott Peck said that true listening requires a setting aside of oneself. And sometimes that means setting aside your personal opinion. He said that sensing this acceptance, the speaker will become less and less vulnerable and more likely to open up the inner recesses of his or her mind to the listener. Again, assume that you have something to learn. Bill Nye, everyone you will ever meet knows something that you don't. I put it this way, everybody is an expert in something. Number three, use open-ended questions. In this case, take a cue from journalists. Start your questions with who, what, where, when, why, or how. If you put in a complicated question, you're going to get a simple answer out. If I ask you, were you terrified? You're going to respond to the most powerful word in that sentence, which is terrified. And the answer is, yes, I was, or no, I wasn't. Were you angry? Yes, I was very angry. Let them describe it. They're the ones that know. Try asking them things like, what was that like? How did that feel? Because then they might have to stop for a moment and think about it. And you're going to get a much more interesting response. Number four, go with the flow. That means thoughts will come into your mind and you need to let them go out of your mind. We've heard interviews often in which a guest is talking for several minutes and then the host comes back in and asks a question which seems like it comes out of nowhere or it's already been answered. That means the host probably stopped listening 2 minutes ago because he thought of this really clever question and he was just bound and determined to say that. And we do the exact same thing. We're sitting there having a conversation with someone and then we remember that time that we met Hugh Jackman in a coffee shop. And we stop listening. Stories and ideas are going to come to you. You need to let them come and let them go. Number five, if you don't know, say that you don't know. Now, people on the radio, especially on NPR, are much more aware that they're going on the record. And so they're more careful about what they claim to be an expert in and what they claim to know for sure. Do that. Err on the side of caution. Talk should not be cheap. Number six, don't equate your experience with theirs. If they're talking about having lost a family member, don't start talking about the time that you lost a family member. If they're talking about the trouble that they're having at work, don't tell them about how much you hate your job. It's not the same. It is never the same. All experiences are individual. And more importantly, it is not about you. You don't need to take that moment to prove how amazing you are or how much you've suffered. Somebody asked Stephen Hawking once what his IQ was, and he says, I have no idea. People who brag about their IQs are losers. Conversations are not a promotional opportunity. Number seven, try not to repeat yourself. It's condescending and it's really boring. And we tend to do it a lot, especially in work conversations or in conversations with our kids. We have a point to make, so we just keep rephrasing it over and over. Don't do that. Number eight, stay out of the weeds. Frankly, people don't care about the years, the names, the dates, all those details that you're struggling to come up with in your mind. They don't care. What they care about is you. They care about what you're like, what you have in common. So forget the details. Leave them out. Number nine, this is not the last one, but it is the most important one. Listen. I cannot tell you how many really important people have said that listening is perhaps the number one most important skill that you could develop. Buddha said, and I'm paraphrasing, if your mouth is open, you're not learning. And Calvin Coolidge said, no man ever listened his way out of a job. Why do we not listen to each other? Number one, we'd rather talk. When I'm talking, I'm in control. I don't have to hear anything I'm not interested in. I'm the center of attention. I can bolster my own identity. But there's another reason. We get distracted. The average person talks at about 225 words per minute, but we can listen at up to 500 words per minute. So our minds are filling in those other 275 words. And look, I know it takes effort and energy to actually pay attention to someone. But if you can't do that, you're not in a conversation. You're just two people shouting out barely related sentences in the same place. You have to listen to one another. Stephen Covey said it very beautifully. He said, most of us don't listen with the intent to understand. We listen with the intent to reply. One more rule, and number 10, and it's this one. Be brief. All of this boils down to the same basic concept, and it is this one. Be interested in other people. You know, I grew up with a very famous grandfather, and there was kind of a ritual in my home. People would come over to talk to my grandparents, and after they would leave, my mother would come over to us, and she'd say, do you know who that was? She was the runner-up to Miss America. He was the mayor of Sacramento. She won a Pulitzer Prize. He's a Russian ballet dancer. And I kind of grew up assuming everyone has some hidden amazing thing about them. And I think it's what makes me a better host. I keep my mouth shut as often as I possibly can. I keep my mind open, and I'm always prepared to be amazed. And I'm never disappointed. You do the same thing. Go out, talk to people, listen to people, and most importantly, be prepared to be amazed. Thanks.
So, how much did that make sense? How many of those rules do we break every single day? So don't multitask, be present. And she assumes no phones, no interruptions, no whatever. But is she just talking about don't multitask, don't have things in your hand? What is she really talking about? Don't multitask in your brain. Be totally present. That's right, focus. Don't pontificate. Assume that you have something to learn. You should not come into a conversation with, I'm going to make them believe what I believe. So I do this every day badly. I do this every day badly. Ask open-ended questions. This is one that I do very well. So ask open-ended questions. This is one that I do often. So far, can we use all these things in our everyday life? Yes. Can we also, though, use them in 5Q and be getting better at what we do in our business and with our clients? If you don't know, say you don't know. Don't try to one-up them. I do this all the time. If you tell me a story about baseball, I'm going to tell you my story about baseball. If you tell me a story about flying, I'm going to tell you my story about flying. Don't do that. The conversation should be about them. It's going to make you an expert conversationalist. Try not to repeat yourself. Anybody that has talked to me or coached with me, do I do this? Do I make my point over and over and over? Yes. We don't want to do that. Make your point maybe once, maybe twice, but you don't need to do it more often. What's a better way to make my point? What's the best way to make my point? What's the best way to make my point? Yes, let them make it for me. Let them make it for me. Stay out of the weeds. I talked about this all the time, and I use the example of the Bible. When the Bible tells us or it gives us stories about parables about how to be better human beings, how much detail do they go into? Not a lot. They get right to the point of the story. Listen. Goes right back to don't multitask. Listen and be brief. Don't go on and on and on about things that you need. So I'm going to ask Missy, would you guys find this slide helpful to put on your desk or on your wall or whatever, if we attach it to the call? Awesome. And like I said, I read this every single week. And should I try to do all 10 of these things every single week? Going right back to the beginning of our conversation. No, that's right, Dale. What should I be doing every single week? One at a time, Ron. Exactly. One at a time, Tom, Nick. Exactly. So good. So I'm going to call the call early because we'll get you this so you can print this and put it somewhere you can look at least once a week, if not daily, and work on just one thing. And you should all be doing what once we get off the call? Should all be doing what once we get off the call? Getting a journal. That's right. Getting a journal. Super. So I can't tell you how much I appreciate you guys. Thanks for being on the call today. And hopefully it was helpful. And we will talk to you all next week. Have a great week, everybody.